Welcome to the Local Anesthesia Strategies module. It's pretty tough to do anything in Crown and Bridge without first giving some local anesthesia, and so hopefully we will get profound anesthesia, and it would also be nice if it didn't hurt the patient or stress out the patient too much. All the surveys I've seen when they ask people, what are your stressors about going to the dentist? It's the injection and it's the handpiece. We're gonna have to use the handpiece and we are gonna have to give injections, but there's probably some ways we can reduce injection pain. At a base minimum, I saw what my dad used to do. I remember coming down from dental school and watching him practice, and he would grab the patient's lip and he didn't use any topical. I mean, certainly topical had existed for, we were using it in dental school, up in dental school, but he would just grab their lip and he was pretty violent about the shaking that he would do there. I mean, it wasn't just, you know, some kind of gentle shaking. It was, you know, violent, like stretching the lip almost to its limits. I didn't see him tear many frenums as he was doing this. When I give multiple carpials, this 1 minute per carpial is really just for the first carpial. And then I go much quicker on the second and third carpials because at this point we don't have to take quite so much care because that same pathway is already anesthetized and the patient's not feeling it. My dad, on the other hand, was far closer to 1 second per carpial. And you think I'm kidding, but he really, he had this amazing ability to just empty a carpial very quickly. So you'd have the oral earthquake going on from him. And then he would just quickly go to the hub, the needle's in, and as the needle penetrated and went to the hub, that's when he would give the anesthetic and kind of come back out in one movement. It's remarkable. If you ever try that technique, it's very difficult to do. He was left-handed as well, but had a very talented left hand. And so he could just go in, boom, and then out again, and it was done. I've tried it too many times. I end up squirting the anesthetic too soon onto the patient's face. Or other times I go in and out and I go, that was pretty good. And I realized I didn't move the anesthetic at all. I just went in and out during the shaking. So it's tough to do. I was taught 1 minute and that's what I stick by. I feel that's a much easier way to be able to do it than that 1 second technique that he would use. So let's look at some devices for possibly reducing injection pain. This is the DentaVibe. Pretty much all of these are doing the same thing my dad was, but in a much less violent way. So, you know, rather than grabbing someone's lip and attempting to tear it off the periosteum and their skull, these are also going to stimulate those fibers and hopefully so that they can't feel it through the pain fibers. I was really worried about giving painless injections long before there were Yelp reviews of dentists online. And, you know, when it comes to things like that or asking patients for positive reviews, I think this is a really good way to be able to do something like this. The Wand by Milestone Scientific. It basically forces you to give a slower injection. I don't have the heart or the intestinal fortitude to give 3 separate injections on a patient. And that's kind of become my technique for not missing blocks. I just don't think I was using enough local anesthetic for the first 15 years of my career. So being able to actually give 3 cartridges of 2% lidocaine, 1 to 100,000 epi, but only have 1 penetration with the needle is certainly a patient-friendly strategy. There's also buffered local anesthetics, and these are not something that you're going to probably need every day that you're in your practice, but when you do need them, you're going to be really glad that you have them. And so when do I like to use this? My mother was a great example, and maybe that's the reason why I feel passionate about these. She was very difficult to numb. She was fair-skinned. She was red-haired. You've seen in the literature sometimes that these people are difficult. It's heartbreaking when it's your own mother. You're trying to show off and look like you know what you're doing, and it's not working very well. As you'll see with all these buffered anesthesia, cost is one of the reasons why people probably don't use it on more of a daily basis. Because otherwise, it's hard to find really anything negative to say about these except for the cost, and there is a significant cost. Here's another one. This is Anutra from Anutra Medical. And in this one, you're actually doing batches of buffered lidocaine, for example, instead of just doing it carpial by carpial. The Gow-Gates technique, I didn't learn it in dental school, and the more dentists that I talk to, I don't find that many dentists that have learned it in dental school, even today. And one day here at the laboratory, we had Kathy Bassett, who is a local anesthesia instructor for a dental hygiene school up in Washington. And as we were talking, she had heard of the lab and wanted to take a tour, and I was asking her about injections. And I mentioned the Gow-Gates, and I said, I'm sure you don't teach that to your hygienist. And she said, no, we do. I said, you do? She said, oh, absolutely. Everybody, for years, everybody who's graduated from there, all the hygienists know how to give a Gow-Gates. And there was another dentist here at the time, and she had just graduated from dental school 2 years earlier. And I said, you just graduated. Did you learn how to give a Gow-Gates? She said, no, I did not. And I was like, this is crazy that the hygienist, why are the hygienists being taught this? Not that that's anything wrong with that, but why aren't we as dentists being taught this? I can see I got out in 88, that's one thing. But this dentist who graduated 2 years ago, I thought it was crazy. And so I had this idea. I turned to Kathy and I said, will you teach me how to give a Gow-Gates? She said, sure. And I looked at the dentist. I said, will you let me give you the Gow-Gates? She said, love to. And it was just kind of this serendipitous moment where we decided that I would learn live on camera how to give a Gow-Gates injection for the first time, which has a miss rate of, you know, 1-3% at most compared to the 25% with the Halstead technique. So what I'd like to share with you right now is Kathy Bassett instructing me and teaching me, and I want you to watch me give my first Gow-Gates injection and how easy this seems.
So when I come in, I want to choose the height of my penetration in respect to the mesiolingual cusp of the molar.
Okay. Well, I'm really happy I got a positive aspiration on my first one.
Fun.
A, with you here, and B, you know, just to see how to, you know, just a little nice refresh on how to handle it well.
Wow, look at that. I got bonus maxillary anesthesia in addition to the Gow-Gates. That's no more difficult to give than a standard IA technique that we're taught in school. So as long as Kathy was here and I had my willing participant of a dentist in the chair, I asked her if she would show me or teach me how to do the anterior middle superior alveolar injection, and here's how that went.
Well, Kathy, the great part about you being here is I get to do another new injection for the first time with your guidance. And you didn't even grab my hand during the Gow-Gates, so that was pretty awesome. So per your instructions, we're looking for where the curvature meets the flatter aspect of the palate right across, right in between, say, the two bicuspid, so right in here. And you mentioned pushing around. And so again, we're coming. We kind of, as you said, park the bevel against the bone so it's not coming across like this where we would hit the tip first and
correct,
the bevel wouldn't be against the bone. We want to kind of make sure that that angle of the bevel is going to be right against the bone, as you mentioned.
And if you can turn,
you want to turn
the side,
this way?
If we can get it, and you can see the blanching from the mesial of her second molar through to her first bicuspid.
Look at that.
Have you ever blanched a palate like that? That's pretty cool. That made me feel powerful for some reason. We should have the blanch palate challenge where maybe we can all, kind of like the ice bucket challenge or something. But so as we close out this module on local anesthesia, you know, I'd ask you to take a look, maybe starting with your topical technique. You know, could you be more precise if you use the varnish or the patch? Or would you like to upgrade to the stronger one because you're not happy with your benzocaines and maybe get the one that's got the tetracaine in it? And are you gonna look into things like upgrading your lower block technique? You know, are you missing it kind of 20 to 25% of the time like the literature says, where you're having to come back and give multiple carpules and now you're behind schedule waiting for somebody who goes, I can't tell if I'm numb or not. That Gow-Gates technique, it might seem scary initially, you know, for where we're heading for the condyle with that injection. But I'm here to tell you it's no different than that lower block, and you get to have the confidence of knowing that the success rate is much higher at 97-98%. So why wouldn't we use something like that rather than having to go back again? And if you do anterior cases with multiple teeth, take a look again at that AMSA injection. What a fantastic way to get profound anesthesia on multiple teeth. So when it comes to crown and bridge, certainly local anesthesia is a big part of it. And I hope you're gonna spend the time and find the ways to make it less painful and more effective for the patient. Thank you.
Are you enjoying this instructional video? I hope so. If you'd like to receive additional clinical instruction with AGD and ADA approved CE credits, all at no charge, be sure to visit glidewelldental.com/education, where in addition to over 60 on-demand clinical courses, you can also access our weekly webinars along with other valuable content.
So when we take a look at the cost of buffered low anesthesia,